AdoramaTV presents Digital Photography 101, where we answer your questions. Here's your host, Mark Wallace.
Hi everybody, welcome to another episode of Digital Photography 101. Well, we have another viewer special this week, and that's where we go in rapid fire format and answer a few questions instead of just one. And so let's dive right in. And please forgive me if I pronounce your name wrong. We have questions from all over the world, and I'm doing my best to get everybody's name right. And the first question is from Kashik, and he said, I took two landscape shots, one at f20 and the other at f5.6, and to my surprise, the picture at 5.6 looks sharper than the f20 photo. Now, I focused on the bridge in both cases. Can you explain what's going on? Well, absolutely. In fact, to illustrate this clearly, what I've decided to do is try to replicate the shots that you had in the bridge, but we're going to use a really ugly fruit picture in our studio. So let's go take a look. Well, all right, let's take a closer look at how you got those two bridge pictures to look different, even though all your settings except for your aperture value was the same. Well, the truth was you were probably in aperture priority mode, which means your settings weren't all the same. Your shutter speed changed, and so we're going to duplicate those results. So I have my camera here. I have it set to aperture priority mode, and my ISO is 800, and we're going to start out at an aperture value of 5.6, just like the bridge shot that you showed us. And so I'm going to take a picture of this really ugly fruit right here, and when I take a shot, you can hear how my camera was pretty fast on the shutter. It was 50th of a second at 5.6, and we can take a look at that, and the fruit looks okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this aperture value and go all the way up to 22. When I do that, now when I look in here, my shutter speed says a third of a second, and you can hear how that shutter speed was really slow. In fact, I'll do it again. Just listen. Okay, a very slow shutter speed. Now what that means is any camera movement is going to turn into blur. And when we look at this picture, sure enough, you can see that our fruit is all blurry. And the same thing has happened to you when you took the picture on the bridge. And so it wasn't that your picture was out of focus, it was that your picture had a lot of blur in it. And that can happen even if your camera is on a tripod, just a little bit of movement for a third of a second. And I think actually we took a look at your pictures and the EXIF data showed us that it was taken at 1/6 of a second, which is a really slow shutter speed, and that causes that blur, which can be misinterpreted as an out of focus picture. So the key here is try to keep your shutter speed up to at least a 1/60th of a second or faster, or use a tripod and a cable release, or you could have some blur and that's gonna throw your pictures all off. Well, I hope that answers your question. There are a couple episodes that we made that could make things even clearer. One is episode 14, all about the aperture and the settings and what those mean, and episode 16, which is about exposure. Well, our next question comes from Ahmad, and Ahmad asked, what is bokeh in photography, and how can I make photos with good bokeh? Well, bokeh has to do with the aperture in your lens, and good bokeh makes the background fall out of focus in a really pleasing way. It looks sort of creamy, and specifically, things that are round should look to be round when they're out of focus, because that's how our eye sees things when they're out of focus. If you had a lens that has bad bokeh, what's going to happen is those out of focus round things are going to look more like stop signs than nice smooth round things. And so that is the best explanation I can give you for what good bokeh is. It's a lot easier to understand by looking at some of these photos where you can see that the background in good bokeh pictures just looks nice and smooth and creamy and round, is very round. And the bad bokeh pictures, well, the background looks jagged and not smooth and not creamy, it just doesn't look very good. Now there are a bunch of lenses that will help you get good bokeh, and that's really what you need to take good bokeh pictures. What I like to use is an 85mm 1.2 lens or something very close to that. And we did a review last year on great portrait lenses that will give you a phenomenal bokeh. We have some 50mm and 85mm lenses. So if you're watching us on YouTube, we've posted a little link or a button you can click to go to that episode. And again, also in episode 14, we talked a little bit more about aperture and how that affects everything. So great bokeh is going to come from a great bokeh lens, and that's how you're going to get those pictures. Well, in episode 67, we had a question, actually a comment, posted on YouTube, and it said, why did the background go gray after you removed the black cloth? Wasn't the background white? Well, absolutely, the background was white, and specifically, this was the episode we were talking about shooting for black and white photography, and our white background did not stay white, and there's a good reason for that. And to understand that more clearly, we're going to go duplicate those results in the studio. All right, well, let's take a closer look at why that white background is going to gray. I have a setup here that's almost, it's very similar to what we had in episode 67. We've got our camera and our studio, our speed light, and our pig back there, and our white background. Now, with this setup, I'm gonna take a picture really fast. I've already focused this, so I'm gonna take a shot. And we can see that picture, we get a nice pig, but the background is absolutely gray. Now, the reason for that is this flash right here, it's illuminating our pig, and we're getting a lot of light right here, but that light is falling off due to the inverse square law, so it's getting dimmer and dimmer and dimmer and dimmer, and so finally when it hits this, well, there's not enough light to make this white, and if we did make this white, well, the light up here would be so bright that our pig would be overexposed. In fact, I'm gonna show you that right now. I'm gonna go over here to my camera, and I'm just gonna take a shot. I'm gonna increase the output of my flash by 3 stops, so I'm gonna make it a really bright flash. And I'll take a shot, and you can see that that background isn't completely white, it's close to white, but our pig is totally blown out. And so to get our pig properly exposed and to get our background to be white, we have to have the same amount of light for exposure purposes on our pig and our background. So to do that, what we would have to do is either take the pig from here and move him all the way back close to the white background, and that's gonna give us some bad shadows. And so the other option would be to get another light and illuminate this so there's just as much light falling on the background as there is on the pig. And if we don't do that, that white background is always gonna fall to gray. Well, to fully understand what's happening there in our setup, make sure you look at a couple of different episodes. Episode 59 is all about the inverse square law. By watching that video, you can see how light falls off pretty dramatically depending on how close the light is to our subject. So that'll help you out. Also, make sure you check out episode 17, and I talk a little bit more about how ambient light behaves when we're using flashes. And then, of course, if you haven't seen episode 67, Lighting for Black and White, make sure you check it out because it's a pretty cool episode. Well, we had another comment that was posted on our YouTube channel, and it said, "I suggest you avoid questions that people can figure out just by reading the manual." Well, that's great input. Unfortunately, if we did that, we wouldn't make any videos at all, because just about everything we talk about, you can understand by reading a manual somewhere. And we have to understand that some people are beginner photographers, and so by reading the manual, it doesn't make much sense, because it's talking about terms they don't understand. And so we're here to help people at all different levels. And so if you watch a video and it has some information that is something that's old to you and you know all about it, well, you can help us out by adding comments and helping people that have questions about that topic. So if you're a more experienced photographer, then join us and help teach your fellow photographers. And if you're a new photographer, well, we're making videos for you on a regular basis. And once you learn this stuff, you can help us out by answering questions too, because we realize just reading the manual doesn't always work for everybody. Well, there's another episode, episode 25, where I talked about through the lens metering, and we got a great question from a person named Lau. And Lau asked, "Do you shoot per the LCD screen or the meter? I try to achieve a good exposure by following my LCD screen." Well, that is actually not a very good thing to do, because just because the way things look on the LCD screen, sometimes they look great, and then when we go to print those or look at them on our monitor, our computer monitor, they look underexposed or overexposed, because that LCD screen is not a very good indication of proper exposure. In fact, what happens is if you're shooting outside in really bright sunlight, well, that LCD screen is going to look dim, and so you'll tend to overexpose things. And the opposite is true. If you're shooting in a dark environment, well, that LCD screen is going to be really bright, and we can tend to underexpose things. So what you should do is expose things according to the meter in your camera and not the LCD screen on the back of your camera. And we've got a couple of videos that will help you out with that. Episode 16 is all about exposure, and episode 25 is all about through the lens metering. Well, this question comes from Kazio, and this person said, "Can you mount a softbox on a Nikon SB900 Speedlight, and will it work outdoors?" Well, Kazio, absolutely, you can mount a softbox on pretty much any Speedlight, and you can use it outside. In fact, we've used one made by Lastolite. It's the EZYBox Hot Shoot, and we really love it. And the reason we love it so much is it's made specifically for Speedlights, and that's what you should look for. You should look for a softbox that's made for Speedlights, because Speedlights don't have as much power as a studio strobe, so you can't use as large of a softbox, but you can absolutely use one, and you can use it outside. In fact, the EZYBox Hot Shoe is made for shooting things like wedding receptions and on-location portraits and location work. And the cool thing is with a speed light and a little portable softbox like that, you can have an assistant help you out and shoot some things on location. It's really easy to pack up. They're less expensive. And so they're really, really a good solution. Now, we used the EZYBox hot shoe in a couple episodes. We did a product review of some Lastolite products, so you can get more information about it there. We used it in episode 29, where I talked about using self-portraits. And then for more information, really, about the differences between the power outputs and recycle times and all kinds of stuff between Speedlights and Strobes, make sure you check out episode 54, where we go a lot more detail into those kinds of things. Well, we received a comment on episode 53, which was shooting in manual mode, and the comment said, "I've heard anything over ISO 800 will produce a lot of noise in the photo. Is that true? In this video, you change your ISO to 4000. Is that okay? It seems like you would produce a lot of noise." Well, that is actually true on some cameras. It really depends on the type of camera you're using, because newer cameras have a lot less noise at higher ISOs than older cameras. And there are obviously some cameras that are made, most notably the Canon 1D Mark IV and the Nikon D3S, that are made for really extreme high ISO usage with low, low noise. In fact, we love those cameras because you can shoot in almost complete darkness with no flash, and you get almost no noise at all. But the problem is, they're pretty expensive cameras. And so there's a lot of things that go into how much noise you get in your image. And so what we've done is we've taken a couple of pictures to sort of compare different cameras at different price ranges at different ISO levels. And we've posted those to our Flickr page. And you can see a couple of these here, where you can see at ISO 800 and ISO 1600. They're not the same for all cameras. One might be noisier than the other. And so there's a lot to look for when you're looking for that. Now, there's a big thing that will have an impact, and that is the size of your sensor and the dynamic range of your camera, and some things that we covered specifically in episode 41. So this is something that we could take a lot of time to talk about, but I suggest that you go look at episode 41, because that's really where we talked about those things and why those things are happening and why on some cameras ISO 800 looks different than on other cameras. So again, check out episode 41, all about dynamic range, for more answers to this question. Well, that's all the time we have for this week, and we'll keep doing these rapid-fire viewer feedback videos about once every 2 months or so, and unless you tell us you want them more frequently, we'll keep it to about every 8 weeks or so, so we can answer a lot of questions in a rapid and short period of time. So thanks so much for joining us this week, and remember, if you have a question about photography, please send it to me at askmark@adorama.com, and we just might use it on an upcoming episode. And don't forget to subscribe if you like these videos, and that'll make sure you don't miss a single episode. Well, thanks again for joining me. I'll see you again next week.
This episode is brought to you by Adorama TV. Visit the Adorama Learning Center, where you'll find photography tips and techniques, links to the gear used in this episode, and related videos. For all the latest photography, video, and computer gear, visit Adorama.com. And the next time you're in New York City, visit our store, located on 18th Street between 5th and 6th Avenue.
Oh, now it's me.